Our next speaker is, like David Ehrenfeld, an existentially committed conservationist. Doug Tompkins is a wilderness advocate, a mountaineer, and founder of the Foundation for Deep Ecology, which has supported a tremendous amount of visionary work in exploring a different paradigm for our relation to nature. He is the founder of the Conservation Land Trust and Conservación Patagónica, and the author of, just lately, 180 Degrees South, Conquerors of the Useless. Let's welcome Doug Tompkins.
Just to give you a little bit of atmosphere, you'll be seeing a sort of a continuous reel of photographs that are self-explanatory in general, although they have some big headings. And this is just to kind of put the context on a few of the remarks I'm going to make, and of course many people have been making during the course of these 2 days. And I just want you to just sort of let them go by, and maybe it'll kind of sink in that what we're seeing here is the consequence of the techno-industrial culture that we're immersed in, a system that's wrecking the world. The reason why we have conservation movement, why we have an environmental movement. And it's taking lots of forms, and it's accelerating. So just kind of let those things cruise through your mind. And as Jerry said, images, once they go in, they stay in there. So I hope that will kind of help sensitize ourselves to this. We use these kind of images. Some of you may be familiar with the books that our foundation publishes. Tom Butler, who you heard a little bit earlier, speaking about the most recent book on overdevelopment, overpopulation, and overshoot. It'll be out shortly. I noticed there are a few books out on the stands out there. One of the recent ones was book on energy that we did in cooperation with Post Carbon Institute. They're activist books aimed at what we call, and I'll touch on it in a little bit, the building of the intellectual infrastructure that's necessary to get a systemic analysis in the minds of activists, first and foremost, and then to widen that circle out to the leadership, which might be the political leadership or the press or the professional side of society. 2 or 3% of society usually takes the rest of society with it. I call that 2 or 3% the leadership. And those are the ones that, as activists, I think we have to activate and to get to push the bar up on their understanding and deep systemic analysis of the issues that are in front of us. To start out, I'd like to talk about the current and to me one of the most potent weapons of mass destruction, the cell phone. And I propose, because I'm sure that I'm talking to literally a room of 100% socially responsible activist types, that we should take that cell phone, and I'm also assuming that the majority of you might have it, although we are in a group here which I've already talked to some people who don't have cell phones. But in any case, whether it's yours or somebody you know, in your family, friends, associates, anywhere, take that cell phone and make a little experiment. It takes a month to do it, but it takes 5 seconds every day. 10 seconds every day. And take that thing and just hold it out there in front of you and look at it and let your mind go back through all the processes that you can imagine that it took to get that cell phone in your hand, that little apparatus, that little device in your hand. And there you'll see what I think Wes Jackson invented the term. You will see the scaffolding of civilization that holds up the manufacturing. Let's not even discuss the use of this thing yet. The manufacture of that little device. And we have the mining, we have the refining, we have the machines that do the mining, we have the machines that make the machines that do the mining, we have the transporting system, we have the houses that the machine operators live in, we have the roads that they travel on and on and on. And that is the thing that's producing what you're seeing up here on the screen. And this is the techno-industrial culture, which I don't know a better word for it than that, but it is destroying the world. So it seems logical, it seems prudent, it seems intelligent that we make a deep systemic analysis of how this got to be, and that the development trajectory, the notion of progress, is tied in to that idea of the techno-industrial direction and form of development. And so far, if we trace it back, we can get back into the epistemologies, the worldview flowing out of the Enlightenment, the scientific revolution, and so forth. That brings us today to the so-called information revolution that's taking place and is manifested in this little small portable, highly accelerating device called the cell phone, which is a little computer you carry around with you. And of course, it's got other negative side effects we know about. It's produced a narcissistic society that everybody's taking pictures of themselves with. But leaving those kind of trivial things aside, its main function is to accelerate the transfer of living nature to that of the realm of production, basically. That's what it does the best. And when it was being invented, really, as an outgrowth and now a miniaturization of the PC, the personal computer, I was living in San Francisco in those days, was friends with Steve Jobs, and we used to talk about this. And of course, here he was promoting this. This was the road to paradise. This was the techno-utopia. And he'd get real huffy with me when I told him that it was going to do nothing but destroy the world. And he came out with this fantastic advertising campaign. You may remember it. It was splashed across every single print media you could see. And it was telling you about the thousand wonderful things that technology was going to bring. And of course, like all messiahs, these were all good things. But in our conversation sitting around at my house in San Francisco late at night, I kept getting on his case about how come all those thousand things that nobody could argue with only added up to 5% of what this magical device did. The other 95% of it was all negative. It was the conversion of nature to the realm of production, and it was accelerating this process. So this got me at that time, this is almost 30 years ago, thinking deeply about the question of technology. And I think, and my advice, for what it's worth, and of course, we have a room full of people who have been thinking deeply about this, But for many of us, even close colleagues, we have to learn from each other. And we have to build this intellectual infrastructure in our heads to be able to make a real solid systemic analysis. And that these technologies are not neutral, that they have inherent logic. I hope we'll hear some more from Langdon Winner, who's really developed this idea and is one of my mentors in this line of thinking, that when a society adopts any given technology, it's going to be obliged to behave according to the dictates of that technology. This is a sort of a critical, I think, linchpin in the arguments of this systemic analysis. Once we get that, we can start to put up an adequate filter about the kind of technologies that we allow into the culture. And until we get that, I don't think you can really see it. And I think once you do that, you'll start to roll the clock back, so to speak, and unroll many of these technologies, these mega technologies, because they have to have, just like that cell phone, they have to have the whole scaffolding of civilization to hold them up. And it's the scaffolding and the existence of the scaffolding that becomes the problem. And we can't escape that. It's obliging us to build a techno-industrial culture. And that techno-industrial culture, we can go through the worldview that's built on the mechanistic worldview. I already heard some of that earlier from Charlene, that we're using the wrong model. We're using the machinist model rather than nature as model. And once again, Wes is just sitting here off to my right. We'll tell you about nature as measure in much greater detail. But if we're using nature as the model or we're using the machine as the model, I find is one of the watersheds upon which we're able to reframe a worldview that could possibly, with no guarantees, give a rapprochement with nature and human societies. So I take that if we use, as I don't know exactly what Wes is going to be saying, but I've been listening to Wes for 20-some years, so I have a general idea what he'll be talking about. But I suggest that we use biodiversity as the metric, biodiversity health as the metric, the overall metric, that the replacement of the GNP or even well-being indicators to see how the human project is faring. That if we use biodiversity, because if we continue the extinction crisis, the mother of all crises, to its logical conclusion, and if humanity would somehow magically survive that, we'll be sitting on a sand dune with cockroaches and a few Norwegian rats, and that'll be the end of it. I use biodiversity as the measure. And if we're not slowing down now and reversing the extinction crisis, everything else is irrelevant. Social justice, as laudable as it is, important, needs to be a half step behind and on the shoulder of biodiversity conservation and the ending of the extinction crisis. Because if we can solve the extinction crisis, most all other problems will start to fall in line or be within reach of solving. It will not guarantee an equitable society. I understand that. That will have to be worked on by itself. But there will be no social justice, as they say, on a dead planet. So we have to put it half a step behind biodiversity conservation. I see that that's resonating with some of you. And that's not to, for a second, to undermine social justice efforts. Those have to be going on simultaneously. But I think it would be good that we, the green, the reds, and the reds, green, the reds get, the greens get redder. So, an ethical stance. I think that we haven't talked too much about ethics so far, but I think that this is the thing that informs our own individual behavior. And again, if biodiversity is the metric, I think that sharing the planet with other creatures is the phrase, perhaps, that best articulates my sense of how we can find an ethical stance. And again, if we take that seriously, and we believe in that, and we work towards that, even immersed in the techno-industrial system that we're trying to transition out of, or we'd like to transition out of, we will have a good ethical position, and that will filter back literally into everything that we do. From an activist standpoint, another point that I think is worth making is that there's a tendency, a strong tendency, for us to jump to action, to jump to strategies. And I just caution our fellow activists to spend more time on the substantive, systemic, deep systemic analysis of the issues that we're working on. Again, that's one of the reasons for the books that we do. The last point is that of hope. Every day we're getting negative and depressing news. We see it right and left, especially if we're in the activist community. This has a demotivating and enervating impact on us. I just wanted to point out that all of you, in whatever part of the social movement you see yourself, you're in an unstoppable movement, be it the peace movement, feminist movement, social justice movement, the conservation environmental movement. These are unstoppable movements. If we take a look at the modern environmental movement started, in 1962 with Rachel Carson's book, and it's just been expanding out and out and out since that time. And I don't see any signs that it's flagging. That it, of course, is responding to a bigger and bigger crisis, but it's unstoppable. Can it stop and reverse the crisis that we're in? That I don't know. We'll have to see. In any case, to finish up, I'd just like to read a poem that will be helpful maybe to give us some vision. And this is a poem that was written 2,700 years ago. But it seems to fit what we need to be thinking about today. Better to keep your country small, your people few, your devices simple, and even those for infrequent use. Let people measure life by the meaning of death and not go out of their way to visit far-off places with nowhere to travel and little care for display of great ships and shining weapons become mere relics of the past. Let people recover the simple life, reckoning by knotted cords, delighted in a basic meal, pleased with humble attire, happy in their homes, taking pleasure in their rustic ways. So content are they that nearby towns so close the sound of dogs and roosters forms one chorus. Folks grown gray with age may pass away, never having strayed beyond the village. Thank you.